verses. We are turning to Matthew chapter 6, as we continue our study in the Sermon on the Mount and in the Lord's Prayer specifically. Next Lord's Day evening, we're also having a special event at the church. There's going to be the unveiling of a plaque in the hallway to our brother Sandy Lennox, a founding member of this congregation, long-standing elder and treasurer for over 48 years, and we do want as a session, as a committee and church, to have this memorial to your brother, and it will be unveiled next Lord's Day evening. So please remember that special service as well that our brother, Reverend Cranston, will be taking part in, but that plaque will be unveiled next Lord's Day evening. We're turning to Matthew chapter 6 and verse number 9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank thee for this passage. We pray, Lord, you'll write it upon our hearts today. We ask you, Lord, you'll open thy word and shine that light of understanding upon it. Lord, empty us of self and sin, empty me of self and sin. Fill me with thy spirit, I pray. May God be glorified in the proclamation of his truth. For we ask it in Jesus' name, for his glory alone. Amen and amen. We come to the last part of what is commonly called the Lord's Prayer, or the prayer that the Lord taught his disciples to pray. And it is verse 13, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, in the previous verse, verse number 12, there are prayers which deal with sins that have already been committed. So forgive us our debts or our sins. And we were reminded as we looked at that, that as we're asking the Lord to forgive us, we have to have the grace and forgiveness that the Lord shows to us, shown to others who have committed sin against us. But while sins of the past are dealt with in verse number 12, sins of the future, potential sins, are dealt with in verse number 13. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And in this verse, we see the vulnerability of the disciples and their need to constantly depend upon the Lord for the avoidance of sin. And we simply want to break this verse into three parts. Lead us not into temptation, part one, but deliver us from evil, part two, and then the rest of the verse we'll call part three. And we just want to look at these as we have time this morning, and we pray the Lord will speak to us. Now, it says in that verse, lead us not into temptation. That's the first part that we want to look at. Now, some people believe that this petition is asking that they will never face temptation at all. And there is an erroneous teaching that you can get to a point in life where no sin brings any temptation to you at all. In other words, you're pretty much perfect. You'll not fall in any way because you're not tempted to sin. Well, what can we say about this petition? First of all mankind, every single one of us, men, women, boys and girls, are subject to temptation and to trials. And therefore, this cannot be some request to live some superhuman life or existence where there are no trials or temptations. As the sun shines on the just and the unjust, so trials and temptations come upon us all. So we know that within keeping of all Scripture, and we have to interpret Scripture by Scripture, we know that this is not asking to be free from the reality of temptations and trials. There are various verses that prove this. For example, the Bible tells us, and I'll just read these two verses, Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 18, "For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor or help them that are tempted." That's Christ. He was tempted. The friend of the Lord Jesus Christ endured temptation and faced temptation. We cannot ask not to be. Rather, we're told that he is able to help us because he has suffered temptation also. And then, of course, it says in James 1:13, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." And it says, "Let no man say when he is tempted." Not if, but when. And therefore, we realize that we will be tempted. Every day we find some temptation, something that will cause us to be drawn away after ungodliness, or something that will cause us to be less like our Savior or less holy. So we know that mankind is subject to temptation. So it's not a deliverance from temptation. And we also know that God allows us to be tempted. Now, God does not tempt us to sin, but God does allow us to face temptation. Now, why that happens is debatable. And many great men and Bible scholars have come up with various answers. Sometimes they say the Lord tempts us to prove us, to reveal our strength, to reveal our faith in him. Sometimes to strengthen us, because whenever we stand firm against temptation, then we grow and mature in our faith. Sometimes it's to make us aware of our need for him. You know, if there were no temptations, we'd be awfully proud and think, well, I can do this and I can live this life and I can be faithful. But we forget sometimes that our strength and our power is not what we can do, but what God does and can do and will do through us. And therefore, whether it's to prove us or to strengthen us or to draw us closer to himself or to make us be aware of our need for him, God does allow us to go through periods of temptation. It says in John 16:33, "In the world ye shall have tribulation." And in that word is also included the thought of temptation, difficulties, uncomfortable days, uncomfortable moments, uncomfortable decisions. But here's what the Lord says: "Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Be of good cheer, because I have victory over the world, and therefore in me, in Christ, you can have victory over the world. God does not tempt men to do wrong, but he permits us to be tempted. We read this morning in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and I believe these are very important verses that maybe would sum up what exactly we're trying to say this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. "Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." Now, what do we mean by that? Well, you see, we all will fall, and we all do fall daily in thought, in word, and in deed. Now, some people fall in a very great and a very public manner, maybe fall in particularly grievous sins. And it can be very tempting for us to say, "What is he playing at? Why is he doing that? That's awful that he did that. That's shocking that he did that," without remembering and obviously putting out of our mind that we also have fallen. And while our fall may not have been as great, as it were, in so many of our minds or our eyes, the reality is we can get to the point where we start judging others and forget about our own vulnerability, our own weakness, and our own feelings. It's very important to remember we need Christ. A friend, if you see a brother or a sister fall in sin, it's not for you to line up and kick them, but rather it is for you, first of all, to pray for them that they would be restored. Secondly, to pray for yourself, because what has happened to them could very possibly happen to you. Maybe not in that particular sin, maybe in another sin. And therefore, not only do you pray for them, you pray for yourself. Only someone full of pride and very short-sighted will point the finger and say, oh, that's awful, that's terrible, and that's as far as that will go. Yes, it is awful, yes, it is terrible. But we seek to save that person, and we seek to bring them back to where they ought to be, but we also must pray for ourselves. And then there's a wonderful encouragement here in verse 13. There is no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. And there could be people in this congregation this morning, and you just feel, well, nobody knows the temptations I face, and you don't want to share them because they make you feel uncomfortable, and you think people will feel ill of you. And the devil often puts this thing in our mind, nobody's doing what you're doing or going through what you're going through or thinking what you're thinking or tempted in the way that you're tempted. And the reality is, the Bible says, there is no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. Millions of people are going through it. But that's not the point. The point is this. God is faithful. He is faithful. And when temptation comes, he provides a way of escape. And that is like a fire exit. Get out of the building immediately because there is a fire. That is exactly what the Lord provides you with, a way to escape from the temptation, from the consequences of the temptation, from the actual temptation itself. And he will not allow you to be tempted above that you're able. So don't think you have to give in to temptation. Don't think it's too overpowering. Yes, it is for you, but not for the Lord. And if you call upon him, he will give you grace to come through it, whatever it is. Now, what is a temptation for you may not be a temptation for somebody else. What's a temptation for me may not be a temptation for somebody else. But praise God, whatever it is, the Lord is faithful and will bring you through when you call upon him. So therefore, we've realized that all mankind are subject to temptation. God does allow us to be tempted. Therefore, if that's the case, what is this petition asking us or asking of God? Well, it is asking that we will not be overcome by the temptation, that we'll not sink underneath the temptation. We're not actually praying against having any temptation, but rather we're praying to have power over temptation, that it will not have power over us, but we will have power over it, that it will not destroy us, but through prayer and by the grace of God, we will destroy its purposes and plans and go through with God. Now, of course, no Christian desires to be tempted or tested, and we do pray to be delivered from it, but we know that weaknesses in our lives and sins in our lives are failure and not victory. And God wants us to live in victory. And therefore, what we're praying for here is victory. Lead us not into temptation. The fact is, Lord, don't allow us to come to temptation and to be overcome by it. But when we're brought to temptation, take us through it. Take us forward. Give us victory. Help us to say no in the power of God. One Bible commentator said, either by removing the temptation when it's too strong for us to withstand, or by mitigating its force, or by increasing our strength to resist it, as God shall see most for his glory. And sometimes when we pray, Lord, help me with this temptation, the Lord will take the temptation away. Sometimes the Lord will weaken the power of the temptation. Sometimes the Lord will strengthen us to take us through that great temptation and bring us out the other side. That's what we're praying for. Lord, take us through the temptation and bring us to the other side. And that's what we're asking. And the thought really when you consider this prayer is not that simply we will have an easy life. That is not the motive behind this prayer. But the motive for this prayer is a holy life. Not an easy life, but a holy life. Now, isn't it interesting that he is praying that he will remain strong spiritually? You see, there are many things that can affect our body, and sometimes we do pray that the Lord will touch us and help us within our body. You see, there could be physical sickness, there could be poverty, even death can come and go against the body. But he's not praying for those things. Yes, he's prayed that the Lord give him his daily bread, but in this point, he's actually praying against the spiritual dangers he'll face. Because the spiritual dangers are much more dangerous than the physical. Indeed, we must emphasize that prayer alone is not enough for you to have victory over temptation. That might sound like a very strange phrase. Prayer alone is not enough for you to have victory over temptation. Do you remember whenever there was sin in the camp in Joshua's day and Joshua got before the Lord? And Joshua prayed that the Lord would deal with sin in the camp, and Joshua prayed that the Lord would reveal the culprit, and Joshua prayed the Lord would be glorified, and that the people would give victory, and that they would walk with God again. And what did the Lord say? Why are you upon your face? Get up and do something about it. You see, it wasn't enough for Joshua to pray. Joshua had to deal with the sin. And friend, it's not enough for a man or a woman or a boy or a girl to pray, Lord, lead me not into temptation. And then open up a magazine that brings temptation into your very eyes and into your mind. It's not enough for you to pray, Lord, lead me not into temptation, and then walk into a bar or a nightclub. It's not enough for you to pray, Lord, lead me not into temptation, and then turn on the television and the channels or on the internet to things that you should not be viewing and that would actually lead you into temptation. The prayer must be accompanied by practical measures that we put into place to guard ourselves from walking into temptation. You see, the Lord will not do for you or me what we can do for ourselves. And there are steps that we can take. We can refuse to lift the book or the magazine. We can turn off the television. We can stop going to places where temptation is presented so openly. And in all of these things, we must accompany it by prayer, because our efforts alone will not be enough. And that prayer on its own is not enough, but we must pray and do what we can. And together, the Lord will give us victory through our temptations. Scripture teaches us that there are principally three attacks that come upon us as believers: the world, the flesh, and the devil. Now, the world is speaking about the world system. And basically, that is the teachings and the attitudes and the beliefs of the world that are contrary to the Word of God. Because you see, there are things in this world that are actually good. There's charitable organizations that are good. There are governments that are ruling well. And there are systems in this world that are good. But this is talking about anything in this world that's contrary to the Word of God. We call that the world's system, because it's not of the Lord, it's of the devil. And having said that, if there's something that contradicts God's word, then it's of the world and we are not to follow it. Now, what are some of the world's things? If it feels right, do it. Friend, that is not what the scripture says. Scripture says, if it is right, do it. If it's wrong, do not do it. So you can see the difference. Bible says you can say you are whatever you feel like. You can identify as a man or as a woman or as about $100 things, if you feel like it. The Bible says God created them male and female. And talking spiritually, the Bible says you identify one of two things: as a sinner or as a Christian. So the world system contradicts the scriptures, and we must hold to it. Not only that, there is the flesh. Now, whenever the word flesh is used in scripture, it's talking about all sinful desires. Not just immorality, although that is included, but it's also speaking about lies. And whenever that desire to tell a lie, to get out of a tight corner, or that desire to paint an untruth to make you look better, that is a lie. That's of the flesh. Pride, when you go about, there's nobody like me, I wish they would do things my way, that is the flesh. All of the sins that we desire can be called fleshly. And then there's the devil. And therefore, in our everyday lives, we experience certain temptations that are placed before us, thoughts that are presented before us, options and opportunities that are presented before us, blatant attacks of the devil, specific temptations, often with the tag promising satisfaction, fulfillment. It won't cost you anything. Nobody will know. And then you give in, and the next thing, the devil's sitting beside you, whispering in your ear, why did you do that? You're some Christian. God can't use you now. Oh, yes, the world, the flesh, and the devil. We're bombarded by the world. We're never away from the flesh, and the devil is always bringing before us those things that are ungodly. We can't fight against these things on our own. But friend, it's foolish for a Christian to allow these things to come before their eyes or ears, to take themselves into places where these temptations abound unashamedly. We must be careful what we expose ourselves to and what we allow ourselves to be exposed to. And putting those practical measures in place, we must pray, Lord, you do what I cannot do. Give me the victory. Now, there is a very good reason for us to pray, because the devil's desire for us is that we will be tempted and therefore become weak. Whenever we fall in sin, we lose our assurance. We lose our power and service. We lose our Christ-likeness. We lose our gentle Christ-like spirit. All of those things when we fall in sin. Therefore, it is imperative that every believer today does what they can and puts steps in place to stop sin coming into their lives and to even stop temptation coming into their lives as they can, and pray on to the Lord to keep them. The second part of this statement says, but deliver us from evil. Whenever we're found in temptation, we should pray for deliverance. Now, interestingly, the word there is the word evil. The word evil can mean the evil things or the evil one, the devil. So you can pray for deliverance from evil and from the evil one. Now, the word deliver, it means to rush or to draw near, to rescue. And it's used several times in Scripture. Now, we are going to look at a few of these verses where it talks about deliverance, because this is what the Lord can do for you today. He is your deliverer. And Christian, be encouraged this morning. I know temptation is real. I know it's hard. I know there are times when we're drawn in two directions and it seems so hard to get the victory. But I have good news this morning. There's a deliverer for you, and he will bring you through. This is the one whom you're calling to this morning. You see, we need a deliverer. In fact, everybody in the service needs a deliverer. We need one who is able to deliver us, first of all, from our sin, from the guilt of our sin, from the record of our sin, from the punishment of our sin in hell. We need to be delivered, rescued. We need someone to rush and rescue us, because we are a heartbeat from hell this morning, those who are not saved, and you need a deliverer. But praise God, there is a deliverer. And we find in 2 Corinthians 1:9, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raiseth the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. So he has delivered us, he is delivering us, and we trust that he will yet deliver us. Isn't that wonderful? He has done a work of deliverance, he's still doing it today, and praise God, in the future he will be able to deliver us. In fact, in 1 Thessalonians 1:10, it talks about Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. And I would ask this morning, before we go any further, to each person in this gathering, men, women, boys and girls, are you saved? Have you been delivered by the Lord Jesus Christ? Is he the one who has delivered you from sin into righteousness? From the broad road to the narrow road. From a sinner to a saint. Only Jesus can do that. Only when we ask the Lord to come into our hearts to save us, to repent from our sin, only then, by faith, can we be delivered by the Savior. The Bible says he's ready, he's willing, he's able to save. And even this morning, the unsaved can call upon the Lord for deliverance. In fact, the very word salvation means to be delivered from your sin. We've come to the end of another year. To another year of gospel preaching. We've had mission this year. We've had Bible conference this year. We've had times whenever the Lord has drawn graciously near and people have been saved this year. But you're sitting in God's house this morning and you're not saved. You need to be delivered. Praise God, the deliverer is here today. The one who can lift you from the depths of your sin and place you in heavenly places with Christ. The one who can make you clean by the blood that he shed in Calvary. That's why we sang that hymn this morning. I do believe. I will believe that Jesus died for me. And on the cross, he shed his blood from sin to set me free. Do you believe that this morning? All then by faith go to Christ. Be delivered from your sin. But I would also speak to God's people this morning and encourage you, ask for the deliverance of God. And it's interesting, whenever we come to God's word, there's just a couple of verses I'll turn you to. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 11, we read about this deliverance. Paul's speaking, and he says, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all, the Lord delivered me. You know what I am rejoicing to tell you, dear believer, this morning? There is no circumstance too difficult for the Lord to deliver us from. Isn't that wonderful? Wherever you are this morning, I realize in a congregation of this size, everybody is in different places. Some are maybe really rejoicing this morning, and life's good in many ways, and the blessings are there. There's some maybe are in great difficulty this morning, maybe in great need. Some in the valley, some in the mountain. Some have laughed today, maybe some have even cried today. But there is no circumstance too difficult for the Lord to deliver us through. He is the deliverer. He said, out of them all, the Lord delivered me. Maybe you feel, I have to get through this. I just have to muddle through. No, you have to go to the Lord and he will bring you through. He will carry you through. He's a great deliverer. Interestingly, God can bring us out of wicked situations where sin is all around us. We read, and we'll not turn to it for time, but we do read in 2 Peter 2 and 7, it says, and God delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. What happened there was the Lord brought Lot out of the city of Sodom. Now, only for the fact that the Holy Ghost records for us in 2 Peter 2 and 7 that Lot was a just man, a saved man, nobody would really know, because his lifestyle didn't say very much. He was living in the very gate of the city of sin. And he was vexed with the filthy conversation or the lifestyle of the wicked. Now, while he was not maybe actively engaged in it, it was all around him. It's in his mind, it's in his ears, and all of those things. And then we have to remember this, there's a real need to think about our choices as believers and how they will affect our family members. Because if you remember, Lot lost his family. He lost his family. But thank God, God can come, and God can overrule our circumstances and deliver us out of places that even at times we don't think we need delivered from. Right, maybe the Lord has delivered you out of a job and you don't understand why. Be the Savior testimony. Maybe God has delivered you out of circumstances and you don't understand why. It's for your good. And I'm sure Lot would have lived on and sought him, only God came and God delivered him. Praise God for the times he delivered us from circumstances, situations, and things that are not pleasing to him. But if you turn with me to Romans chapter 11, there's a lovely verse. And it says there in Romans chapter 11, and it is teaching us of who Christ is. Romans chapter 11, verse number 26. And so all Israel shall be saved. Now, before we go any further, I just want to let you know what that means. Some people take this to believe and believe that every single Jewish person will be saved. Now, once again, we cannot lift a sentence out of Scripture and make that the standard. We must interpret it with Scripture. We know that Paul says there are those Jewish people who will not be saved. They're lost. They will not turn and they will not trust Christ, and that grieves us. But the Bible says here, and so all Israel shall be saved. Well, Bible commentators believe that's talking about time in the future when there will be a turning onto God of Israel as a nation. Now, that doesn't mean every single Israelite or every single Jewish person living in the world will be saved, but it will mean that on the whole there'll be a turning onto the Lord Jesus Christ by the nation of Israel at some time in future days. And that's something to look out for whenever many, many Jewish people shall be saved and the nation as a whole shall be saved. And it says here, there shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is a covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. Friend, they'll be delivered from their ritualism and from their traditions to follow the new and the living way, the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a wonderful picture that presents to every single person here. Because our Deliverer has arisen, and those who are saved have been delivered, and he turns us away from ungodliness. That's the purpose of our deliverance, to turn us away from ungodliness. And this is his covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sin. God promises to turn us away from ungodliness. And then whenever we read in Peter, we come to that wonderful conclusion in 2 Peter 2. It just says this, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations. And that is 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. So friend, if the Lord knows how to deliver you and me out of temptation, are we crying unto him? Are we calling unto him? Are we struggling with sin and trying to fight the battle on our own, and we can't do it, and yet the Lord knows how to do it? We have not because we ask not. Friend, maybe this morning you're in despair because you've no victory over the world or the flesh or the devil or some sin in your life, and yet this morning the Lord knows how to deliver the godly. Call upon him. Give him that temptation. Ask him for deliverance and praise God. He will deliver you. And not only that, he will reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. And that's interesting as well, because there are many people who say, well, God isn't judging me now. And I've lived without the Lord, and I'm successful. And I'm rich, and I'm popular. And it seems to be that the world loves me. Yes, but the Lord reserves the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. It lies ahead. But praise God, he delivers his people. So therefore, the great three blessings, as we consider this statement, delivers from evil, there is a great deliverer. We ought to pray for deliverance. Lord, bring me through. And there is no temptation so great, but the Lord will bring you through it. And then finally, we finish off with this doxology. And it says, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The kingdom, that is the authority of the Lord. And it's described with the use of this word kingdom. God is identified as a king, indeed the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now this is interesting because it just doesn't say thine is the kingdom, because there are several people throughout this world and you could say that of them, thine is the kingdom, the kingdom that they're ruling over. Whether it's a small island or a great nation, there are kings and queens on the throne. But it says thine is the kingdom and the power. You see, there are many people have a title but cannot live it up to it or fulfill it because of a lack of power. However, we're reminded that all power belongs unto him. In fact, the Lord Jesus Christ said, all power is given unto me. Therefore, go ye and preach the gospel to every nation. You see, the power that is of the Lord is given unto him so we can go and do what he commands us to do. It's his power, the power given to him, the power purchased by him by his death upon the cross of Calvary and the resurrection from the dead. He has all power, and it's yours today. It's available today, whatever your need. His power is sufficient. But not only has he a kingdom and power to rule over that kingdom, but he has the glory. You see, he will receive the glory that he is worthy of. He is worthy that every man, woman, boy, or girl should bow before him and worship him. And someday they will. Someday they will. But when we live a life of holiness, then he is glorified. When the believer lives a life of obedience, then the Savior is glorified. And the true believer whose heart is right with God will always say amen to the prayer of Psalm 115, verse 1. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. And you see a faithful testimony, a faithful worker, a faithful preacher used by God will always say, not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name we give glory. Never rob God of his glory. If God should use you to bring a multitude to Christ, fall down on your knees and say, glory to God. Don't rob the Lord of his glory, because it tells us here, his kingdom and his power and his glory are forever. Oh yes, some people have titles and positions and a little power and a little glory for a period of time, but his is forever. And then we end off with that word, amen. Now the word amen is also translated in the Bible, verily, or truly. So be it, or surely it could be in other translations. It is effectively saying that I have prayed the promises of Scripture, and I prayed the will of the Lord, because I'm praying Scripture, and surely it will be so. Surely the Lord will answer my prayer, because the prayers I prayed are in union with Christ, because they are the words of the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? Whenever we enter into prayer, we enter into fellowship with the Savior, and as we pray his word, we are praying in union with him. And there are two agreeing, touching these things, and praise God, it shall be done. And not only that, but because there is an amen saying verily or truly or I believe it to be, surely it will happen. Every Christian ought to be saying amen at the end of the prayers. Every believer ought to audibly say amen. Why? Because you're testifying before the congregation, but you believe God answers prayer. His promises will be fulfilled. It's not a waste of time, but we're praying believing that God will move according to his word. We've been praying according to his word, and therefore we are not ashamed or embarrassed or too proud to say amen. Amen. Let it be, Lord. And I encourage you in the church service, in the prayer meeting, wherever you be, you say amen audibly before the Lord and honor the Lord, because you believe his word will come to pass. Maybe there's someone this morning and you need deliverance. Well, praise God, there is a deliverer. Maybe there's someone this morning, you've been fighting yourself. Friend, give it to the Savior. Yes, you make those practical changes and things that need to be done to shield you from temptation, and then go to the Lord and say, Lord, deliver me. And praise God, remember, no matter who should rise up in this land, in this nation, in this world, that his is a kingdom, and his is a power, and his is a glory forever. All will give their crowns to the Savior, and eternally we will worship him. We conclude this morning by singing 560, hymn 560. Yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. Each victory will help you some other to win. It's not a sin to be tempted, but it is a sin to give in and allow that temptation to have a place in your heart. So therefore, let's yield not to temptation and ask the Savior to help us. Let's stand and worship God, and then we'll remain standing for prayer.
Thank you.
Father in heaven, we thank thee that the Lord will carry us through. Lord, thou art willing to help us, and thou art willing to protect us, thou art willing to give us a victory. Oh Lord, forgive us for the many times we fail to even ask for a victory, starting off the day without giving it to the Lord. Oh Lord, help us to be faithful. Help us to do what we can, Lord, and then depend upon thee for the deliverance. Thank you, Lord, that thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Oh Lord, some human will raise up and say, I have the power and I'll do this and I'll change things. But we thank thee above all thrones, there is a higher throne, and our Lord is seated upon it in glory and splendor. One day every man and woman who held any authority will bow before the Lord and say, worthy is the Lamb. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless this people, make us a victorious people. Give us grace even this day, in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen and amen.